Jesus, the strength of my life, what shall I be afraid of? Hallelujah. My enemies and my foes come upon me to eat up my flesh. They stumble and they fall. Hallelujah. Though a host encamp against me, even in this, will I be confident. Hallelujah. One thing have I desired of the Lord. That one thing I would want to see, that I might dwell in the presence of the Lord all the days of my life. To behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For the time of trouble, hallelujah, he's going to hide. Glory, glory, glory. God's name is presented. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Let's thank our hallelujah. Let's bless you. God is protected. Hallelujah. I'm going to worship. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Glory. The Lord is on my side. Hallelujah. If God be for me, who can be against me? Got a shout, it's a good time to go ahead and be heard. It's a good time. Hallelujah. That will be a good thing. Hallelujah. Praise is coming for the upright. Hallelujah. And all those who put their trust in him. Let them. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you that we can boldly say and have confidence that whatsoever we ask in your will, you hear us. Hallelujah. If you hear, you will grant. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Well, my soul just got up to the level where I can feel like let loose.
My God.
Yes,
Lord.
Sorry, Lord.
My God.
Oh, it's easy. Hallelujah.
Yes, hallelujah.
Day, Lord, mercy. Hallelujah.
Oh,
hallelujah. Day, Lord, mercy.
Thank you, Lord.
Glory, 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 glory.
Williams wants to read a rose. Would you like to see a red rose right now?
Yes. Yes.
Right.
Glory.
Thank you.
Yes, Lord. Glory.
All yes, right. Lord. Thank you, Brother Williams, for the prayer. That was a little long day. Long day. All right. I just wanted to say a few words before we get started. It's for you that got one more energy. I can tell when my energy gets low when I stop exercising, when I stop walking. And, you know, 80-20 is the ideal mix in terms of alkaline to acid foods. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. Alkaline foods or foods that we shun. That's all I have to say. Acid foods are the foods that we really, really like and eat a whole lot of. And we shouldn't be, should be the other way around. But whenever the balance gets out of whack, then there's a depletion of energy. And so you get tireder, and the body makes a lot more acid. Amen. So another thing that will... Everybody just to exercise. I don't know whether most everybody exercise, right? Sometimes. Three times a week, four times a week, walking. All right. Another thing is that your water consumption should be at least 1/2 of your body weight in ounces. Amen. How many ounces are there? At least, what I say, at least 1/2 of your body weight in ounces. Otherwise, you will severely dehydrate. You will be. All right, and I think vitamins would be good. Whole foods, it comes from all whole foods, because most diets do not consume an adequate amount of vitamins and minerals. So I think everybody should be doing a multivitamin, a multivitamin. Really help you out, you feel a lot better, have a lot more energy. And some other things I don't have time to get into. Amen. But those are some of the things that really will make a difference. Usually I try to walk every day or so, 2 or 3 miles. Last week or two, it seems like so many irons in the fire that I really haven't taken time to do it. I can feel the difference. That's sluggish. Amen. Praise God. How many want to just pray for me right now? That before prayer, I need to get out there and start doing it. Amen. All right. I want to say that you can look around and see how many here. I don't know how what the count is. I guess we have to count before we leave. But we do have Wednesday at 10. We had a few come out today. It's about 7, I guess. Also, we have on Sunday evening at 5. So those are the times that we have fireworks lessons. And you will get basically the same as we are doing on Wednesday night. Now, we have done lesson 2, having God's interest at heart. And those of you that have missed that, you can just work through lesson 2, answer the questions, and you should get basically the gist of what we have shared. I think it's really important. The chapter is very, very important. I think that we've discussed it adequately. Also, a servant of the Lord in chapter 3, this was concerning Moses. And I think we spent 2 sessions on a servant of the Lord. And if you didn't, if you weren't in on these 2 sessions, you can read those sections and fill the questions out. And I think that you would benefit a lot. Okay, now the 4th lesson is following the example of Jesus. And let me see how many of you remember going over this lesson. Anybody remember going over this lesson? Okay, nobody remember. We went over it about twice. Nobody remembers. So we just might as well go over it again. Huh? Lesson 4, following the example of Jesus. Okay. Following the example of Jesus. Okay. Okay, let me see how we want to do this. I'm going over about twice. I think I'll let you all talk and see what you all have gotten from this. On page 33, we'll see how much we can recapture from this lesson just by going over the questions on page 33. Okay, I just want to raise this question first. When did Christ first submit to God's will to die for lost humanity? That's a good question. All of this was covered in that particular lesson. When did Christ first submit to God's will to die for lost humanity? That would refer to Christ in his pre-existent state. Now, that's before he became a human being, before he became flesh. So, ask the question, when did Christ first submit to God's will to die for lost humanity? Okay, do I have any volunteers? When did Christ first submit, according to this lesson? Anybody else? Okay, okay, brother.
You know, but it's involved, man.
Okay, so a little louder.
It's right after the fall, man, when Cutting first, and he talked about, he will flash his hand to the deal or something like that.
Okay. All right. Okay, Sister Pearl, okay.
I don't know what the scripture is after, but as we know, before sin ever occurred, Jesus had a solution. And God had a solution, and that solution was to send Jesus.
Okay. And Revelation 13:8 mentions that Christ the Lamb was slain from the what? Foundation of the world. So that decision was made when Christ was in his pre-existent state. Alright? And when he was had his equality with God before he relinquished all of his power and his mighty power and glory. That decision was made even before there was a sin problem. So Christ was slain. In other words, the decision to be slain from the foundation of the world was even before man even existed. So that was a decision that was made when he was still a part of the Godhead in his pre-existent state. Amen. So the scripture bears that out in Hebrews 10:5. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he said, sacrifice and offerings thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. Okay, but that decision was already made even before he came into the world, right? As a man. Amen. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, thou hast no pleasure. This is on page 27. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me to do thy will. Amen. Praise God. Now, 1 Peter 1:18 gives you a little bit more insight into as to what we are discussing. For as much as we know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation or lifestyle received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained, look at that, before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. So the decision for Christ to come down and die was made before the foundation of the world, when he pre-existed as God, as part of the triune Godhead. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Jesus existed initially in his spirit state. He didn't have a physical body until he came down through the birth of who? Mary, conceived in her womb and became flesh. Okay, so back to that question. Okay, Sister Pearl, answer that question again. You did a good job. Okay, what do you say? So that decision,
Christ as Jesus.
That decision was made before there ever was a world, before man was created, before man ever came into the picture, before man ever sinned, before man was ever created, rather, and before he ever sinned. Okay, now what does that show? What could you say about the love of God? And God made provision for the, he made provision for the answer before that was the problem. Okay, what can you say about God? Okay, Sister Denise. Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation, in other words, the atoning sacrifice for our sins. All right, so what we can say is that God loved us with an everlasting love. Even before we ever came on the scene, God knew the end from the what? Beginning. All right, that's so.
I just wanted to ask you.
Okay,
about, Genesis 3:15. That's when he first told them then, told the man.
Okay, Genesis 3:15. Okay, just read that so we can understand exactly. Your question was what now?
Well, is that about Jesus there, or is that foretelling?
Yeah, that was a prophetic utterance in the Garden of Eden that one day there will be a deliverer, the Messiah. Jesus would be that lamb, and he would destroy the authority of Satan, because when Adam sinned and transgressed, Adam's dominion was turned over to who? Satan. And he ran with that dominion. He is still the God of this world, and he will maintain that authority, okay, over the world, but not over us. The authority over us was broken when we received Christ. And Jesus made that possible through his death and resurrection. So we can get out from under the dominion of Satan. But legally, he has been given that authority even until the coming of Christ, when it will be taken away. Okay, but the authority over us is broken the moment we receive Christ as our Lord and Savior. But he has control, legal control over the universe, and that control was given him through Adam's disobedience, and he will maintain that control until Jesus comes and take that control and dominion away. Okay, all right, let's, okay, everybody in agreement? When did Christ first submit to God's will to die for lost humanity? All right, maybe I should ask somebody else to see. Yeah, okay, let me ask somebody else. All right, who wants to volunteer to let me know you got it? Nobody, okay, brother Holmes. Okay, before?
Before the foundation of the world.
All right, before the foundation of the world, okay. And how did he exist? Exist as humanity, as a human being, or did he exist as God before the foundation of the world? Okay, he existed as God. Okay, so he came in human form, he relinquished his equality with God, so he came down without having all of those, you know, divine prerogatives that he enjoyed as God in his pre-existence state. He laid all of that aside. In other words, he didn't operate in all of those rights and privileges that he had. Okay, let's do number two. Write down three things Christ had to lay aside as God to redeem man. Write down three things Christ had to lay aside as God to redeem man. Okay? All right, who wants to give that? Who wants to take a stab at that? Write down three things. Jesus, that refers to what? The humanity of Christ. So Jesus Christ was both human and he was what? Divine. Alright. So three things that Christ laid aside as God to redeem man was his what? His what?
Power.
His what?
Power.
Okay, his power. Always say his mighty power and glory. If you want to be more specific, he laid aside his glory. And I'm going to turn to Philippians 2. You see the things that he laid aside. See, that's the first way you can really begin to understand the things that Christ laid aside. Turn to Philippians 2. And it lays it out there in detail. And you know, things like when Jesus was praying to his Father just before he went to the cross, he said, Lord, restore the glory that I had with you before the foundation of the world. Restore the glory that I had with you before the foundation of the world. So Jesus laid aside his glory. So he was asking, he was praying that God would restore that. And that glory was restored, you know, after his, after he had paid the price, after the price of our redemption had been paid for in full, that glory was restored back. Amen. So let's look at Philippians 2. Four, I believe it is. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Thought it not robbery to be equal with God. So he laid aside his equality. Right? His equality with God, he laid aside that because we just read that he thought it was not something that he would hold on to. In other words, he was speaking about his equality with God. Now, if you want to get a better translation, I think that we have it in the lesson. Right. Okay, on page 28, so Darlene, Christ, referring to Philippians 2:5, let the same attitude, verse 6, who although being essentially one with God and in form of God, possessing the fullness of the attributes which made God God, did not think this equality with God was a thing to be eagerly grasped or retained. So he laid aside his equality with God. We can see that. That means all of the attributes which made him God, he laid aside all of those. Okay. Now, verse 7, it says that he stripped himself of all privileges and rightful dignity so as to assume the guise of a servant, in that he became like men and was born a human being. Okay, so we know he laid aside his God-given attributes, laid aside his glory. Brother Butler mentioned he laid aside his power. And we can see that these are some of the attributes that he laid aside. All right. So we can just say in the back of the book, if you looked it up, we have his glory, his equality with God, his Godhead privileges, and power. All right. Now his glory, how many can understand the glory? I mean, that's the power of your anointing. You know, if he had laid aside his glory, then people wouldn't have been able to have stood in his presence, because his glory is just too bright, too radiating, too radiant, and he couldn't thrive or survive in that type of glory. So that's the reason why Moses was just permitted just to see the what? The backside of God. Because if he had beheld the real glory, the full glory, then it would have consumed him. So Jesus had to lay aside his glory when he came down to preach and to relate to human beings, because his glory is just too much for us to what? For us to stand up under. All right, everybody got that? Everybody agree that he laid aside his glory?
Yeah.
Amen. How many believe he laid aside his power?
Yes.
All right, so he didn't operate as what? As God, but he operated as a man that was what? Anointed with God. That's the reason why Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath what? Anointed me. So Christ anointing to do the works that he did is the same anointing that we have to what? Receive in order to do the works that Jesus did. Amen. So he laid aside, if he came, if he already had all of that, then he wouldn't have had to what? Depend on what? God's anointing. He wouldn't have had to pray and say that the works that I do are not my works. Right? Why did Jesus have to pray all night? If he had all of those attributes in place as God, why would he have to pray for God to what? Equip him, for God to lead him, for God to speak to him, and for God to work through him. So he had to come down in the form of a servant, and he had to lay aside all of those rights and privileges that he operated in as God before he became man. So we can understand why he laid aside his glory. Is that right? We can understand now why he laid aside his what? Power. Amen. Because if he hadn't laid aside his power, then we would say, I can't do what Jesus did, because he had what? Power. Inherent power. I mean, he was God. Who expect me to do what Jesus did? But Jesus removed the excuse. And the way he got his power and the ability to do the works of God is the same way we get our power. We get it from the power of the Holy Spirit. Right? Amen. He said, the works I do are not mine. Okay, now, there are some scriptures. And I won't sound like a broken record. You've heard this over and over, but nobody volunteered to articulate it, so I just felt like I needed to go over it again. On page 31, you see, page 31, you see, he totally trusted and depended upon God for his anointing and power. John 3:6-38. For I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that what? Sent me. Okay, so you see there that he was not operating in his own will. He was coming down from heaven to carry out the Father's will. All right, John 8:28 says this, I do nothing of myself. I do always these things that please him. That shows that he was operating not in the strength of his ability, but he was operating in the strength of the Holy Spirit. All right, now John 14:10, the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the what? The works. All right? All right? Can we say the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works? Can we say the same thing? Can we say like Jesus without, amen, without him, I can do nothing? That's what Jesus said. I can do nothing without my Father. All right, now Matthew 12:28 goes further. He says, I cast out devils by the Spirit of God. All right, Luke 4:18, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me. So Jesus was completely dependent upon the Spirit of the Lord to do everything that he did as a man. And all of us are what? Men. We are women, right? And we are human flesh. So our strength and the source of our ability also comes from the same source, which is the Spirit of the Lord. Amen. There's a scripture which says that my sufficiency, do not think of ourselves, don't think that we can do anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of what? God. Amen. I think this lesson is designed to show you that we have to approach the works of Christ the way that Jesus approached them. Because if you look upon the task and the commission and all that God has assigned us to do as something that we have to do in the strength of our ability, then everybody would have a what? We would have a good excuse. We would just throw up our hands and we just said, well, the test is just to what? Great. We wouldn't even try. Amen. God wants us to understand that without him we can do nothing. But when we let go, amen, and what? Bible says submit to God, and when we begin to approach our call and our mission as not having the ability to do anything as of ourselves, that will drive us to do the same thing that Jesus did in order to be fully equipped. Amen. That drove Jesus to what? Prayer. And we can see that he spent night after night, you know, in prayer, 40 days and 40 nights, even before he performed one miracle. Jesus spent that time in what? Prayer. Now, as I was sharing today, that we really, when we began to face tasks that are insurmountable, it is really to our advantage to get alone and begin to what? Pray and let God begin to what? Rise up in us. Because, you know, most times when we face conflicts, it's just too much for us to even attempt to do in the strength of our own ability. So you have to wait on God. But the Bible says, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Amen. Some of the greatest crises I've ever had. I've had some crises that we had to pray for days and days and days and days and days before the anointing rose up within us. And when that anointing rose up, because we felt, you know, that we were not up to the task. We felt like we were, you know, fighting a losing battle.
But as we begin to wait on the Lord, as we begin to feed on the Word, as we begin to pray, then God began to what rise up within us, and the anointing began to what take over, and amen. Then we began to what catch hold to what God's strength, God's power, and then that boldness. How many know that when you pray and when you wait on God, amen, holy boldness began to what rise up within you. Amen. Although we have authority, we have it all the time, but many times we cannot really sense, and we cannot really, amen, act on it, because that authority that we have is kind of lying what? Dormant, you know, and we just won't act. But when you get full of the Holy Ghost, you begin to what? You begin to rise up. How many can say amen?
Amen.
So Acts 10:38 says this. Everybody read this with me. How God did what? Anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with what? Power. Who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. For God was what? With him. So that scripture kind of clears that up. How God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and with power. So that shows that God had to anoint him with the Holy Ghost and power. He didn't use the power that he had in his pre-existent state, because that power was laid aside. He came down so he could depend strictly on the Spirit of the Lord. Amen. You know, the Spirit of the Lord is the third person of the Trinity, right? All right. Okay. Does that satisfy everybody that he laid aside his glory, he laid aside his what? Power, and he laid aside all of his divine privileges that he enjoyed as God. Okay, let's move further. I'm just doing the questions in the back of the chapter there. State five things Christ experienced as a man that let us know that he became like us. Okay, state five things Christ experienced as a man that let us know that he became like us. All right, that's a good one. Five things Christ experienced as a man that let us know that he became like us. All right. All right, what did he experience as a man? I'll give you one. Okay, Sister Sheridan?
I got my ass back up the
book. All right, what does that back of the book say? All right, it's better than knowing it.
He was tempted in all points as we are.
All right, so since you read it out of the back of the book, you're going to have to break it down. You're going to have to explain it. Okay, what do you mean? How was he tempted?
Well,
in all points as we are. Specific temptation that you can remember that Jesus confronted. Any specific temptation that you can remember that Jesus confronted as a man. Anybody can help us, Sister Sheridan? Sister Sheridan was dependent on my answer. It's not too good to depend on the arm of the flesh. All right, Sister Denise. All right. All right. Okay, he was tempted in after his 40-day what? I mean, during this 40-day fast, right? He was tempted in the wilderness. All right. All right. Anybody else remember any other temptations? Persecution, a lot of criticism, a lot of gossip. There were assassination attempts on his life, right? How many remember assassination attempts on his life? Okay, these were all temptations. Whatever we go through, he went through. Whatever experiences that we face every day. Now, if you want to turn to some specific things, and I could have gone right down the line and explained this again, but I thought I would just not do that.
He was tempted by prayer.
Well, he had doubt.
Beg for it?
He had doubt. My God, why hast thou forsaken me?
Yeah, okay. Well, he had, right.
And he asked that, you know, if this isn't really necessary, I don't want to go through with it. He said, take this cup from me, nevertheless.
Right. That's good. That's good. Because he had to struggle in prayer. In the Garden of Gethsemane, right? He had to struggle in order to what? To stay in faith, to go through all of the horrible things that he was about to what? Confront. And the Bible says he was there in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he was he prayed so hard until what? He shed his what? Drops of blood. And the Bible says that he offered up prayers with strong crying. I mean, the travail in prayer. Jesus, amen, had to travail. He had to really pray, just like a woman bringing forth child. That's the way he had to pray in the Garden of Gethsemane, because that experience was so horrible. He was facing spiritual death. He had to become sin for the world. In other words, it would be the first time since the foundation of the world from eternity that he had ever been separated from his Father. So that was a load on him as well. So these were things that Jesus had to face in terms of his temptations. And we can go down, we can itemize a whole lot more, but that was one of the temptations that he confronted as a man, okay? All right, let's name one or two more other things. We mentioned that we wanted to mention five different things. Our sister Shirley, read the second thing I have there.
He had to depend on the Holy Spirit to minister.
Okay. He had to depend on the Holy Spirit to what? To minister. Okay, now we are naming five things that what? What are we talking about here? Okay, that Christ experienced that what? That show us that what? All right, so he had to, Sister Shirley, read the second one again.
He had to depend on the Holy Spirit to minister.
Okay, everybody agree with that? We just talked about that. He had to depend on the Holy Spirit to what? Minister. We are trying to get over in this lesson that Christ was in every way just like us. Well, that's hard for us to what? Conceptualize, I guess. It's hard for us. I mean, if we could ever get that through our spirit, our minds, and really get into our spirits, I think that we would begin to approach ministry altogether different. Anybody agree with me?
Yes.
That's probably the most difficult thing to do, is to see Christ, amen, like we are today. Because we'll always hold this back in our minds that Christ was what? He was God. Well, he was 100% God. But also he was 100% man. Okay, although he was 100% God, he did not use any of those what? Rights and privileges that he operated as what? As God. So that takes away the excuse. He did not operate in any way with all of those pre-existent power that he had as God. I know this might seem difficult, but if you could ever get a revelation of it, that I can do all things through who? Christ that strengthens me, greater is he that is what? In me. And take your attention off of your flesh, your limitations, and your weakness, Your lack of education and lack of all of the things that we make excuses with and see ourselves as a what? Man just lack who? Jesus. And how God anointed James Hill? With the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about what? Doing good, healing all of those that were oppressed of the devil, for God was what? With it. How many believe that you can do the same thing if God is with you and God has empowered you? It's no more I, but it's the what? Christ that what? Lives in me. Okay, Sister Shirley, amen. I'm glad you turned to that section because at least you found it. Give her the third thing there. But you're pretty smart, Sister Shirley. You found the answer. You're like you, Sister Shirley. All right, come on, give me the third one. All right. He had to, amen, acquire what? Wisdom and knowledge as a what? Man. Now, if he had held on to this wisdom that he had with the Father before he became man, he would have had to what?
Acquire.
He would have to acquire. Amen. How many remember the scripture? Is there a scripture that you can just put your hands on, or maybe you can recall, that said that Jesus had to grow in wisdom and knowledge or anything like that? Okay. Is that scripture somewhere in the Bible?
One of the Gospels.
One of the Gospels, probably somewhere in Luke, somewhere like that. All right, if you look through this lesson, you might find it. All right, okay, so he grew in wisdom and in knowledge and in favor with what? Okay, do I have it written out? All right, so Jesus had to get his wisdom, right? He had to grow, get his favor. He had to get it the same way that we receive it today. All right, now there's an Old Testament scripture too, but we're not going to go there. Okay, that shows that Jesus had to get his wisdom and all of these things that he operated in as a man. He had to get those things the same way we got them. Through studying. Remember Jesus at age 12 in the temple? He knew the word so well. He had memorized the first five books of the Bible. He knew it. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right, Sister Shirley, do we have another one there?
Yes.
All right.
He got hungry, tired, and wept at times.
All right, that's the one everybody can relate to. Read that again, Sister Shirley.
He got hungry.
He got hungry.
Tired.
At times.
Cried at times.
He wept. Yep. All right. Jesus ever wept?
Yes.
Yep. Okay. Is there a scripture?
Jesus wept.
Jesus wept. The shortest scripture in the Bible. Yeah, when John was murdered, Sister Pearl said he had to go aside and pray. All right. Now, I know he wept in the Garden of Gethsemane because the Bible says he offered up strong prayers with strong crying, because he knew God was the only way that he could go through. And in order to stay, you know, Jesus was facing a failure in faith. I mean, he had to pray just like a man, just like us, in order what? To maintain his faith. So he could completely go through what? The ordeal that he was facing, how he was confronted. Oh, I'm so glad that Jesus was just like me. In all points, tempted just like James Hill, but yet without sin. Woo, Lord, that shows me that I can be what? Tempted? Amen. I can confront the same things that Jesus, and I can be equipped to what? To overcome, and I don't have to give in. What? To the devil, because the same Holy Spirit that worked mightily in Christ is the same Spirit that's at work now in me, working the will and the ability to do the will of God in me. Amen. That's the reason why I can say I can do all things through Christ. Amen. I'm excited about that. I can do all things. Amen. How many can just lift your hands up and says, I can do all things? Through who?
Christ.
Amen. Not who was. Strengthen this man. Now, how many would be willing to just confess that, amen, for the next 30 days? I can do all things through who? Christ. Say it again. Oh, amen. See, the more you agree with that confession, then what? The more strength you will get. That's how you get strength. That's how you get equipped. Jesus consistently confessed who he was. He consistently confessed what he came to do. And that's the thing I like about Jesus. He always, those words were always what? Coming out of his mouth as to who he was. And I think that that should be the position that all of us should take as believers. We should consistently confess who we are in Christ. We wouldn't feel so beat down. We wouldn't feel alone. We wouldn't feel so inadequate. We wouldn't feel so unworthy. We wouldn't feel that we have to do all of these things, amen, in the strength of our own ability. Lift your hands so I can do all things through Christ. Amen. Seems like that we doing it. We saying it gradually. I can do all things through Christ. Yes. How many can say, greater is he that is in me? All right, Sister Shirley, is there another one? Is that the last one?
Oh, one more.
One more. All right. What is that one?
His flesh recalled when facing the hour of temptation.
All right. His faith did what?
His flesh.
His flesh recoiled. What does that mean? His flesh recoiled when he was facing the hour of temptation. What does that mean? His flesh recoiled. It's not a too big of a word, is it? Should I put a little smaller word? Okay. Somebody break it down. We got a lot of intelligent people in here. Just break it down for Pastor.
So he wasn't excited about it.
So that, never say you weren't
excited. Well, that's right. I have to, you know, I mean, I understand I will, but just people mentioned earlier, you know, take this cup from me.
Yeah, right. He said, Lord, if you could find any other way, if you got any other plan that'll work besides me going through this, I'm totally in agreement. That's what Jesus was saying in so many words. But finally, he had to face the reality that it's not my will, but what? Your will be done. Oh, I love it. I love it. I love it. Did we finish all of that?
Yep.
Okay, we finished all of that. And we will let you read the chapter. We'll finish it up next week. And we'll finish up the questions next week. And now you go home and read the chapter. You can hold it twice. All right. But we just want to make sure that you get it and we can answer. How many more questions do we have to answer next time, Sister Shirley?
Two more.
How many more?
Two.
Just two more?
Yeah.
All right, so we're in pretty good shape. All right, Sister Shirley, you did a wonderful job. I really appreciate that. Okay. She had those eyes at her fingertips. Oh, I love it. All right, let's all stand. We're going to let you go a little earlier tonight. Amen. Hallelujah. This is a chapter that you want to get a revelation of, because if you get a revelation of it, then you never look upon your task and your assignments and the things you have been assigned. You never look upon it as something that you have to do in the strength of your power. We got to become to the point where we have to depend completely and put all of our trust and our confidence in what? In the Lord. Then we can see things, amen, beginning to take a different course for us. Father, today we thank you and we give you the praise and the glory. Hey, in Jesus' name, Shande Mashiach, the name above every name, we thank you, Lord, for beginning the good work within us. And you who have begun the good work, oh God, it's you that begun the good work. If you've begun the good work, then you have to finish the work. Of course, we have to, hallelujah, there's a part we complain. There's a godless side, and then there's a manless side. But Lord, the strength, all of my help, cometh from you. And I'm going to work it together with you. Oh, God, we thank you. In Jesus' name, we give you the praise and we give you the glory. And we thank you, Lord, for that great peace that you have given to those that love your law, and nothing shall offend them. Father, we give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Everybody just say, in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen. How many know that we are well able? Everybody say, I'm well able. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Amen. 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 God bless you. All right. God bless you.